Alright, hi guys. Hi, I'm Keefe. I'll be your training officer for this year. So just to get a quick survey of this room, how many of you guys did the introduction to university debating session last week? That's the bulk of you. So that was the highest level session available, right? Sorry? Should you say something? Oh no, that's alright. Okay, cool. Right, so basically all of you know the basic format of debating, and today I'm going to run a session on how to approach the topic in setting up a clear problem, a clear model, and then after that I'll talk about some general tips and tricks about how not entering into certain pitfalls when you do those things. So cool. But before that, I'd just like to do a short introduction to training, where I will outline the general methodology around this year's training program. So there are just a few points here. The first is that debating is individual, and that whilst these programs are aimed to be as informative and as insightful as possible, the bulk of your insight and the bulk of your knowledge and skill from within the, for debating will come from practice debates and your personal reflection on how those practice debates went. So debating is mainly about learning from doing, and as much as we would like to lecture you on things, you have to learn from your own experience. The second thing to say is that debating, improvement in debating after the initial phase where you learn how to stand up and give a speech for 7 minutes straight, improvement can become very can take time, and it can come in phases which are staggered and phases which are very sudden. This means that you will plateau inevitably for certain periods of time. But the main point to draw from this is that you should be patient, and the main way to be patient is to enjoy debating, right? Like, I'm in debating not because I view it as, you know, some sort of way I can get validation in my life, but because I love it, right? I think so. But the fact is, debating is something which is very fun, and if you learn the rules and intricacies of the game, it can be a game which is very fun to play, and I invite all of you to learn and play this game. The third thing to say is that, other than the sorts of trainings and workshops that we'll be running, there is a wealth of resources online that you can access and view at your own pace, notwithstanding the stuff that we have on the MAT official website, where I think under the trainings tab we have a list of past debating videos and past matter sessions as well as past training manuals. I would point you in particular to Tim Sonright's work, which is Tim is one of the sort of dinosaurs of debating. He was here maybe from 2000 to 2004-ish, but he's a very, very good speaker, and he thinks a lot about debating, and he has, fortunately, left behind a repository of knowledge, which we can all access, and I also invite you guys to access that stuff. Moreover, there's also a lot of stuff on YouTube, where there are a lot of videos from past World Universities Debating Championships or the Australasian Debating Championships that you guys can access and view in your own leisure as well. The final thing to say is that ask a lot of questions in these sessions, because it is difficult for me to assess what is clear and what isn't, and the best way for me to discover those to discover the lack of clarity is for you guys to ask questions, and asking questions shows me that you guys are interested, and it's always good. Cool. So in this session today, I'm going to cover four things. The first thing is to cover the general spirit of debating and briefly definitions. The second part is to establish a problem, is the establishment of a problem within each motion. The third is to set up a model to address that problem, and the fourth part is just some extra tactics to handle the second and third part a bit better. So, on to the spirit of debating. Debating is fun broadly because it is an opportunity for you to be controversial and a chance for you to be imaginative. This means that the debates which are most fun are oftentimes the ones with the ideas which are the craziest within certain bounds of like reality, right? This means that if you set up a debate with a large and meaningful clash, and by this I mean a debate where both the affirmative teams and the negative teams are ideologically as far away as possible, the adjudicator will usually have a good time and both teams will usually do very well in that debate. This means that you should try not to avoid doing avoid dealing with certain arguments, right? Like a general trend in schools debating, or at least the schools debating that I experience, is that teams would just like try their best to model themselves out of dealing with certain arguments because they were simply afraid or just did not want to deal with those arguments. That is a bad thing, and it means that the debate just loses some controversy and it loses some value. Debates are better if you fight head-on with the arguments that come from the other side. So, with this context set up, the general principles of definition are these. Firstly, fairness and reasonableness. It means that the interpretation of the topic according to your team should accord with what a general person would interpret from that topic, right? So, if, say, the motion is that we would ban student unions, the motion is, to a reasonable person at least, would be about student unions on campus and student unions in university. But some people, as crafty as they might be, might think that unions might allude to marriage, right? And say that, oh, this house would ban student marriage. Like, this is obviously a crazy example, but the principle that I'm trying to illustrate is that the definition should be closest to the definition of a reasonable person. The second is clarity. In short, the definition should be as clear as possible. And this ties in with simplicity as well, right? Like, the definition should not be taking up the bulk of your speech. It should just be pointing to what you guys are arguing for, and that should not take more than a minute or so. In general, definitions which are simpler are usually better. Cool. So that's one point dealt with. The second part is the problem set up. Once you know what you are arguing for and what the other side is arguing against, you now want to argue or at least set up a problematic status quo as the affirmative. Why is this? Because as the affirmative team, you are the team which is there because you guys want to do something. And you guys usually only want to do something if there's a good reason to do so. And that is what we call the imperative for the debate, right? The imperative is made up of three components, or at least this is just a simple way of phrasing it. The first is crisis. Crisis, in short, means that things are bad. So, for example, if I am arguing that, say, Australia should invade New Zealand, you would possibly say that the sheep infestation in New Zealand has reached levels which are unacceptable. Cool? So things are bad. The second part of problem setup is a trend, which is, in short, things are getting worse. So you're not just going to say that New Zealand is infested with sheep, right? It's that these sheep are like reproducing at an exponential rate to the point that, you know, it is unfeasible for people to live in New Zealand anymore. So the trend is that things are not just bad, but they are getting worse. And the final icing on the cake for a problem set up is the tipping point, where you say that things are not just so bad and things are not just getting worse, but they have reached a point where it is unacceptable, right? Where, for example, you have crossed a certain line where things cannot be allowed to get worse. So an example of this would be the sheep outbreak in New Zealand has reached such an unacceptable stage that, you know, people are suffering from viral meningitis. in New Zealand. So that would be an example of a tipping point which gives you, as an affirmative team, a clear signal to say, we have to step in because things have gotten so bad that there is viral meningitis. Obviously, the example is a bit of a farce, but you can easily substitute in any other sort of plausible debating-related scenarios in here. Cool. So as the affirmative team, when you get a motion, the first thing you have to ask yourself is, what is the problem in the status quo? What is the crisis? What is the trend? And what tipping point can I point to which will give me credibility in intervening in this situation? Right. Cool. As the negative team, you will want to do the opposite intuitively, right? The first thing you want to say is that things aren't that bad. So for example, you know, you might say that people in New Zealand just really like sheep and they are okay with it, right? That directly addresses the claim that the sheep problem in New Zealand is a bad thing. The second thing to say, which is the things are getting better, is potentially that the sheep population has reached a cap and the population can only go down after a certain stage because there's not enough grass anymore. So that is a trend which will undermine any credibility in saying that the Australian government should intervene now, right? Cool. The third part is saying that any intervention is simply not worth the harms. So for example, as a negative team, you could say that sure, things might be slightly bad and maybe the population isn't going down, but the Australian government intervening will lead to a kangaroo infestation, which is even worse. Yes, so that directly addresses the sorts of contentions that an affirmative team would want to point to. But an alternative way for a negative team to address the problem construction of an affirmative team is also to just say that you have a better way to solve it. So in this case, maybe the affirmative team is saying that they would run a military intervention to kill all the sheep in New Zealand, right? So what the negative team could do is just say that people in New Zealand would move to Fiji or whatever, right? The point is that you can still accept the imperative of the affirmative team in saying that there is a problem, but still deal with the, but still negate the affirmative team's claim that intervention or military intervention is the best way to deal with the problem. So that is what you can do as a negative team. I'll just run through some real life examples here where this problem construction was played out. The first example I'll point to was in the World's 2010 final, where the motion was this house would invade Zimbabwe, where Monash, in first proposition on the affirmative team, said that Zimbabwe, like Robert Mugabe in Zimbabwe, was like doing bad things to his people, and that he was sort of coercing his people and being a very bad dictator in general. But what we also did was to say that the problem was getting worse and that any hope of any opposition by Morgan Tsvangirai was being crushed as Robert Mugabe actively like did more bad things to him. The details in the video. But moreover, Victor Finkel, who was in the team at the time, also pointed to a certain tipping point where he said that the cholera outbreak in Zimbabwe meant that there was a humanitarian crisis in Zimbabwe, which meant that the international community had to intervene now rather than wait. So this is an example of how these principles play out in a real-life debating example. The next example I'll talk about is the Austros 2004 finals, where the motion was that this house would grant refugees, like this house would automatically grant refugee status to victims of sex trafficking, right? So the affirmative team was saying that refugee status and immediately granting this was the best way to deal with the problem of sex trafficking. And to give credibility to this claim, they obviously had to make the argument or say that sex trafficking was a problem which was bad and it was getting worse, right? So the affirmative team here claimed that sex trafficking wasn't just a humanitarian problem, but it was a problem which was exploding, that more and more syndicates were buying into sex trafficking and there were more and more people being trafficked. This placed a burden on the negative team to say that they had, placed a burden on the negative team to either A, deny that any sex sex trafficking was getting worse, which is sort of a hard thing to do in a debate, right? Where, like the emotionally charged team saying, you know, things are bad, is always the one that adjudicators tend to give more credit to. Or B, they could just say that, fine, things are bad, but we're not going to do this, which makes them seem very lazy and sort of morally irresponsible and negligent. Cool. So now that we know the basic principles of setting up a problem as the affirmative team, you now have to set up a model to deal with the problem which you have highlighted. But before we go into how to build a model, I'll just briefly talk about the purposes of a model. The first purpose is clarity. When you're going into a debate, you usually have the benefit of maybe 30 minutes of discussing what you want to run in a debate with your partner. An adjudicator who is viewing your speech for the first time does not have the benefit of those 30 minutes to understand where you guys are coming from. So it is very important that in your speech you highlight who is being affected, what you're doing, where it is going to happen, how it's going to happen, and why you're doing this. Cool. The second part of this is tactics, right? Sometimes there are certain arguments that you just don't have to deal with from the negative team, and it is simply beneficial for you on the affirmative team to model out those arguments. I understand that this comes into tension with my previous slide on saying that you should take all arguments head on, but sometimes there are just some arguments that you don't have to deal with because they are not core to the debate, but distract you from the core of the debate. All right. So now that you know what the purposes of a model are, you now have to know what sort of model you want to have, in essence. So, there are hard and soft lines. A hard line, in general, means a model which is very different from the the words are a bit distracting. I'll just move back to the previous slide for a while. A hard line means that it is very different from the status quo, and it is essentially very radical. A soft line, on the other hand, means that you're running something which is only marginally different and is essentially similar to the status quo, but slightly better. So the example that I have here is for the motion that we would legalize euthanasia. As you can see, the soft line is very similar to the status quo where euthanasia is banned, but a soft line would only allow euthanasia for incredibly sick people with no hope of cure. It would require the consent of many doctors and psychologists, and the sort of euthanasia that's allowed is passive euthanasia, where doctors would only be allowed to deny food and water and are ordered to not resuscitate the patient in the event of death. Oh yeah, sure. Sign-up sheets? Have they been passed around? Is anyone here who has not signed the sign-up sheets? Oh, cool. All right, cool. Let's have one more going. Can you pass this around the middle? All right. On the other end of the spectrum, we have the insane line, which is that anyone and everyone can have euthanasia whenever and however you want it, which is obviously a lot more radical than the soft line. In the moderate and hard lines, we have something in between. For example, only allowing it in the moderate line for people with low standards of living and a low hope of cure. In the hard line, it's allowed to anyone with a terminal illness, physical or mental. So there are obviously many different choices that are open to you when you are in the affirmative position saying that you want to solve a problem. So how do you pick within these scenarios? So, the first thing to say in choosing a line is that you should never run the status quo. Basically, no motion will force you to run the status quo. If it does, it is usually a bad motion, because the point of debates, point of debating, is to make you propose something controversial and then to debate that change. So how do you pick between a hard line and a soft line? In general, I would say run something hard between the hard and the moderate line. Run something between the hard and moderate line. Obviously, this is something which is difficult to call because debating motions are different, and the approach you take to the debate will change not just with the motion but with the opposition that you're facing, etc. So you have to exercise discretion, but these are the broad principles behind choosing a hard line or a soft line in general. For a hard line, P is pro and C is con, just in case you didn't know. So if you pick a hard line, the benefit of that is that it is usually philosophically more consistent, right? Like, for example, if you say that anyone and everyone can have euthanasia wherever and whenever you want it, it is very consistent, right? Because it applies to everyone. If you pick the hard line, you will have to justify why it is okay for people with a terminal illness, physical or mental, but not okay for anyone without a terminal illness, or like someone in a lot of pain but having an illness which is short of terminal. So those are distinctions that you will have to draw, and it is up to you to decide whether you can defend those distinctions or not. So picking a hard line means more consistency. Yes, and the con of that is that it will usually be harder to defend because you need to defend the borders and the boundaries you draw within your categories. If you pick a soft line, the benefit of that is that it is easier to defend. In a sense that it is easier to defend because it is less radical and it is more conservative. So you could just say that in line with the general, like if you pick a soft line, you could say, you could justify your model by saying that this is in line with the general principle that society accepts, that we respect life as something that is a right which is inalienable, and therefore we only offer it to a small amount of people. But the cons of picking a soft line are sort of manifold. Is that a word? Yeah, it is a word. Cool. The first problem is that it isn't very consistent at all, because you now have to pick and justify why, if you accept that there is a general principle that life is inalienable, that incredibly sick people, on one hand, could access euthanasia under your model, so it is quite difficult for you to run and accept the strong principle of life while allowing it for a few. The second problem is that there also isn't that much to say, because if you run a soft line, your entire case would be about why those certain people very close to death, no hope of cure or standard of living, are the specific people who, for which we require this model, which essentially pigeonholes and shrinks the debate to a very narrow group of stakeholders, and generally that isn't a good thing to do. So it also means that you won't own arguments if you run a soft line. What do I mean by this? The example that Tim Sonright uses in the in his article is this house would ban school uniforms. So the affirmative team, in running a soft line, would say that... ban school uniforms? Yeah, cool. Wait, soft line ban school uniforms is... some school uniforms? Yeah, okay, cool, yeah. So basically, a soft team, a team running a soft line would say that there is a school uniform, but you are able to express your individuality through a badge on your shirt, for example. So it is not a school uniform, but still kind of a school uniform. So the in that debate, the the affirmative team would still have to argue that we are allowing you to express your individuality, right? But then the negative team could just as easily come back and say, if individuality is so important, why are you only allowing a certain square, like on your shirt, to be the sort of the area of individuality for these students, right? So the fact is, in a debate like this, running that line, the affirmative team can never possibly win that individuality argument because it will always be caught in that sort of being conservative and not quite getting the benefits of their model problem thing. Right. Basically, try not to run a soft line. Essentially, you will find a happy middle for most motions. And obviously, some motions have multiple happy middles, and it just requires you to run different lines of argumentation to defend them. But what you need to be is just to be conscious of these trade-offs that you make when you pick a line. Cool. So, a negative team in some circumstances can run a counter model. What is a counter model? It is essentially the same thing as an affirmative model, except you are saying as a negative team that we want to do something as well, just not what you guys are doing, right? So for example, in a debate about invading Zimbabwe, a negative team could just as easily say that military interventions are bad and what we want to do are economic sanctions on Zimbabwe. The benefit of this is that A, it negates the imperative of the motion, right? So the affirmative team can't just say, oh, you guys accept that there's a problem but you're not really doing anything about it, when the negative team can say, yes, we are doing something, it's just not what you want us to do. The second thing is that it refocuses the debate, right? So, in a debate that I was in, which is a debate about charter cities, okay, this needs some explanation. The motion was this house would establish charter cities. And charter cities are basically zones of autonomy where, say, governmental, like city boards are given almost complete autonomy to run public services the way they want it, as long as it accords to the principles of a charter. So basically, it's a debate about whether we should give cities more autonomy or we shouldn't. So in that debate, the affirmative team said that we need charter cities because countries are becoming economically stagnant, right? Labor isn't moving to where it should be, and having charter cities will improve that because those cities can now give tax breaks and give their own sort of tax rates, which are very attractive and will attract labor to where it needs to be. So on a negative team, you could just as easily say that we don't need charter cities and instead we would counter model better tax rates in certain areas of the country, right? Like you could say that we can have better economic activity without having your model. So that's an example of a counter model negating the imperative of the affirmative team. So those are the benefits. What are the cons of counter models? The first thing is that it concedes the failure of the status quo. It means that the negative team now has the burden of explaining why the negative's policy will be the magic bullet which solves the problematic status quo, which gives you more things that you have to argue. The second thing is that it also opens up your model to attacks. So for example, if you're on the negative arguing for economic sanctions on Zimbabwe, you open yourself up to criticism about why economic sanctions would work, and the affirmative team could just as easily point to your case and say that economic sanctions are less scary than a military intervention, and therefore it is less likely that economic sanctions would change the behavior of a dictator. Finally, it also weakens the clash of the debate, where... Oh my god, I need water. Cool. I'll just speak more softly. Cool. It also weakens the clash of the debate because it means that you're ideologically closer to the affirmative team now. Cool. So, now that you know which line you want to run, how conservative you are or how radical you want to be, how do you know which model you want to run? The first thing is to steal a model. So for example, say in a just to use the Zimbabwean debate again, if you want to steal a policy, you could just as easily steal, I think, the UK's invasion of some African country. This is bad. But basically, many military interventions have been done before, and you can just as easily use the sort of proposal that has come up in news outlets or have happened in the past. That's usually the best way to run something, because people usually do things if there's good reason to do it, and stealing means that you get the benefit of someone else considering the pros and cons of a model. The second thing you can do is to modify a policy which exists. This means that you can take a policy which exists and change it in a way to sort of deal with the problems which happened in the past, so that the negative team cannot possibly use those attacks against you. The final option is to invent a model. This is obviously the most difficult thing to do, and it will come with experience, but the pro of inventing a model is that it usually catches negative teams off guard, and it means that they are more unprepared in dealing with your attacks. That concludes setting up a model and setting up a line. The final part I want to talk about is, how much more time do I have? About 15 minutes. Tactics. There are two parts to tactics, right? That's not to say that there are only two parts to tactics, but there are two parts to tactics in this presentation. So the first is the problem-solution gap, which essentially says that the scale of your solution must match the scale of your problem. So an example of this would be an affirmative team which stands up and says, Zimbabwe is in crisis, people are dying, it's a human rights crisis, we have to do something, and then propose a model which says that we will donate $5,000 to Zimbabwe. That is obviously quite exaggerated, and these variants in which this problem-solution gap will appear are a bit more convoluted and a bit more stealthy. But the basic idea is that the affirmative team has suggested a problem which is large and then given a solution which is inadequate with dealing with the scale of the problem. So as a negative team, how do you deal with this? The first thing to say is to say that the model is basically useless and will fail to solve the problem, which is basically just saying $5,000 will not do anything, therefore your policy is useless, so even if there's an imperative, your policy fails. The second thing to do is to hijack the debate. What do I mean by hijacking the debate? So in this debate, if the affirmative team offers $5,000, the negative team could very craftily, if they wanted, say that they would offer $10,000. And accept the arguments by the affirmative team that money would be of value, and therefore we should offer more money and give them more value. The problem with this approach is obviously that it kind of fucks up the debate, and it's completely contrary to the spirit of the emotion, but it's an option that you can keep on the table sometimes. The final option, which I would recommend you do most of the time, is that you run hard arguments anyway, which is that even if the affirmative team says that we want to do something which is small, the negative team should say and stand behind a principle of saying that we should not do anything at all, because the act of doing something would lead to problems. So for example, in a debate where say America, like the affirmative team says that America should donate $5,000 to Zimbabwe, there is still some room for the negative team to say that the act of donating $5,000 to Zimbabwe could A, be seen as an imperialistic act of the of Americans trying to impose its form of democracy onto them, or also B, say that donating that money would prop up the Zimbabwean dictatorship because that money would be funneled most probably to the coffers of the dictator rather than the people. So even in circumstances where the affirmative team makes it extremely difficult for you guys to run a hard line, it is still possible, and most reasonable adjudicators will reward your efforts and your creativity in engaging an affirmative team who runs a soft line. So, the second part of tactics is slippery slopes. Slippery slope arguments are essentially when someone says that your policy does X, X will cause Y, Y will cause Z, and Z is a bad thing. Intuitively, these arguments might seem bad sometimes. For example, if we want to talk about legalizing prostitution, you could say, an affirmative team could hypothetically say, if you legalize prostitution, it means that people would go out and have more sex. And if you have more sex, there'll be more babies, and there's more babies, there's overpopulation. Obviously a very bad argument, but it is plausible that an affirmative team could make an argument similar to it, even though you substitute whatever is in those categories, right? So for example, in euthanasia, right? An affirmative team would say, we would only legalize euthanasia for people who are terminally ill and have no hope for a cure. A negative team could plausibly say that once you violate the principle that life is inalienable and life is sacred, it leads to a slippery slope of more people calling for euthanasia, and that's bad because it means that more people die and it means that more people are tempted to die. It isn't necessarily a bad argument. It's only bad if you don't analyze the steps, if you don't analyze how X leads to Y and how Y leads to Z. So how do you make them work? You show the trend or principle that you will empower through that policy, and that trend will reach a tipping point. So, the example that I will use, again, is euthanasia. Let's take that for example. So, a smarter negative team would say that if you allow euthanasia even for small amounts of people, it means that... Cool, question time! Can anyone come up with a better example for this? Sorry, yeah, you have a question?
You set a precedent that makes it
sense. Yeah.
In some sense.
Yeah.
And people will argue to have a gruesome conservative in their situation.
Yeah, brilliant, right. Cool. Thank you so much, you're amazing. The principle here is precedent, right? So it means, like in law, when you have done something, you have to show that the next action or your incentive to perform the next action is affected by your previous actions. For example, in law, if a previous judge has made a statement or a judgment which says that X is true, a judge in a lower court or in a future court is obliged to follow that principle, even though he might disagree with it. So for example, hypothetically as well, if, say, the Labour Party, the Liberal Party in power, legalizes euthanasia, then it sets the precedent that the Liberals now stand for the freedom to die. And this means that any future Liberal leaders... Oh, this is not a good example as well. But basically what I'm trying to say is that future Liberal leaders might be pressured by party policy to stick to that sort of ideology and therefore have their be more likely to vote for the broadening of euthanasia, that it will reach a tipping point. Cool. But the basic idea is that also when you make a slippery slope argument, you have to be conservative in your claims. This means that you should not argue for crazy consequences. Like the example that I used earlier where the one about prostitution and overpopulation was something laughable because overpopulation was an implausible consequence from legalizing prostitution, right? Yeah. Basically because people use protection and stuff. But the essential idea is that being conservative in your claims will go a long way into making your arguments more sound and making your arguments more persuasive. Cool, that's it. Basically, what have we covered in this session? The first thing to say is that we should always debate in good faith and have the broadest, most controversial debates possible. The second part is to establish a problem, have a clear crisis, a clear trend, and a clear tipping point. Thirdly, have a clear model, pick the line you want, and know how to defend it. Finally, don't fall for the traps of the problem-solution gap, and don't make bad slippery slope arguments.